Help is in the name of the Lord who created the heavens and the earth and who is now making all things new.
Amen.
Amen. Today is the second Sunday of Easter. Of Easter. Easter is an event, but it's also a reality with ongoing consequences. It's like going to a music concert or a museum. You enjoy it, and then you get home or the following day and you just have to share it. You have to talk about it. You have to maybe post pictures or talk about the experience on social media. It happened, but you continue to enjoy it. More fitting, perhaps it's like when you experience an earthquake or an eclipse or something like that. Easter kind of wakes you up like that. Everything can change. Everything can be different in a matter of moments, just like that. Did you know Matthew tells us that when the stone was rolled away, the earth shook? Everything can change in just a moment. He is not here. Christ is risen. Just like that, the earth could not hold Jesus Christ. So on the second Sunday of Easter, we gather as a community to live and to enjoy that reality together. So just like the people in the story that's captured in the scripture, the men and the women, they gather together at that empty tomb with their questions, with their wonderings, wherever they are in their life or their faith in that moment, and they're together at that empty tomb, and they ask their questions, they express their faith and their longings together, and that's what we're going to do. We're also going to do that at the table together today. So no matter where you are in your life or your faith, you're welcomed here and you're welcomed with the love of Christ. So let us love and worship the Lord together.
As you're able, please rise and join with each other in a responsive call to worship. Today the table is prepared, and a place is reserved for all. I have wondered if there was a place on earth just for me. Today the Lord takes the basin and the towel and washes with water. I have wondered if there was someone who cared for me. Today the Lord says, come, follow me. I have wondered if there is a purpose for my life. Siblings who are created in the image of God, our Lord Jesus, who is great in love, has prepared a table and cares for you. Therefore, your life is filled with imperishable worth and meaning. Let us rejoice and be glad together. Our hymn of praise is number 223, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Thank you. You may be seated. United, let us join a prayer of confession found in the bulletin, which will be followed by a few moments for your own silent personal prayer. Gracious God, we see the table set before us. The bread and cup remind us that your body and very life are given to redeem us and your world. There have been times this week that Easter did not last very long inside our hearts, leaving us as empty as the tomb. As we eat and drink, please fill us with your grace and spirit so we may behave in your memory, justice and compassion and good in our community. Give us new life, O Lord. Amen. We confess our dependence upon God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. From Matthew chapter 18 and Psalm 119, hear these words of assurance of pardon. Family and friends with all sorts of faith. One time Peter asked Jesus how many times he should forgive someone. Jesus told Peter to forgive with abundant, never-ending forgiveness. That loving abundance exists for you as well. No matter what you have done or left undone, no matter what lessons you have learned or are still learning, God's abundant grace exists for you. God's love will never run out. So hear and rest in this good news. You are forgiven. You are loved. You are invited to serve. Thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, this is the good news. Thanks be to God.
As it was in the beginning.
Please rise for the passing of the peace. Friends, the peace of Christ is with you.
And also with you.
Let's welcome one another. Seated. Good morning to everyone here and those watching. On the backside of your bulletin, there is a perforated section, which is our welcome card and prayer request card. Please fill that out if you would like to be put on our email distribution list, or if you would like to join in the book discussion group, which is going to start in just a few weeks. I would like to talk about the book discussion group. It's going to be 4 weeks on Monday evenings. The details and description are provided for you. I have copies available today. If you would like, talk to me after the service. You can, on the connection card, just write your name. I either need your phone number or your email address because I need to send you the reading list before our first evening together. So you can provide that information, tear that portion off, put it in the basket later in the service, the basket, the plate. Okay, I have an exciting announcement and a volunteer opportunity for two people from 11:30. The volunteer opportunity is from 11:30 to 12:45 tomorrow, 11:30 a.m. to 12:45 p.m. tomorrow. Okay, here it goes. All right, hold on to your socks, okay? So tomorrow afternoon, United States Senator Kirsten Gillibrand is going to be visiting here, and she is going to be announcing significant funding for our friends at Day One, which is going to allow them to deepen and expand their services in Poughkeepsie and beyond. I could not be more excited and happy for them and what it means for Day One and for the families of Dutchess and Poughkeepsie. And they have asked if we would have two volunteers available to welcome the people who enter our building tomorrow. So if you would like to be a fun, friendly face tomorrow, during that time period, talk to me after the service, please. Only two, not four, two, all right? So first come, first serve, okay? But it's really fun. We should be really, really happy about this. It is such a great opportunity. With that being said, I will invite Mary Ling up.
The elders of the Reformed Church of Poughkeepsie have welcomed Linda Rapp, who appeared before them and made profession of her Christian faith. We ask her now to declare her faith before God and Christ Church, that we may rejoice together and welcome her as a sister in Christ. I ask Linda to come forward.
I noticed today that during the passing of the peace, and I would imagine my smartwatch bears this out, my heart starts beating really fast about this. I get so excited about baptisms and people joining the church just because of the stories that we get to bear witness to and what this moment means. I love moments like this. Linda, I'm glad you're here. Everyone, I'm glad you're here too. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Hear also the words of the Holy Scripture. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Water cleanses, purifies, and refreshes. Water sustains. Jesus Christ is living water. Through baptism, Christ calls us to a new obedience, to love and trust God completely, to forsake the evil of the world, and to live a new and holy life. Yet, when we fall into sin, we must not despair of God's mercy, nor continue in sin. For baptism is the sign and seal of God's eternal covenant of grace with us. So Linda is joining us. She's been baptized, but when someone joins, we pour water because we are asking her to remember her baptism. And we read those words from Scripture reminding us that even though we may come from different faith traditions, Linda comes from a Presbyterian church in Wappingers, that there is one baptism because we serve one Lord, right? And that's a beautiful thing about Christianity. Also, Linda is a pastor's kid, so she automatically gets my empathy. And maybe a halo, I don't know. And so I do hope that after the service today that you'll spend some time with Linda, introduce yourself to her, share some of your life with her, and ask some questions about her. So, Linda,
You are beloved of God. And I ask you before God and Christ Church to reject evil, to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, and to confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce sin and the power of evil in your life and in the world?
I do.
Who is your Lord and Savior?
Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior.
Will you be a faithful member of this congregation through worship and service, seek to advance God's purposes here and throughout the world? Congregation, I'll invite you to stand as you are able. Do you promise to love, encourage, and support this sister by teaching the gospel of God's love, by being an example of Christian faith and character, and by giving the strong support of God's family in fellowship, prayer, and service? If so, say, we do.
We do.
We will now confess together our faith as it is expressed in the Apostles' Creed. In one heart and one voice, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Members of Consistory, I'll invite you up as we pray for Linda. Why don't you step in front? Yeah. Linda, remember that you are baptized and that you are sealed by the Holy Spirit, marked as God's forever and called to join Christ in his mission. Let us pray. Defend, O Lord, this your child and servant, Linda, with your heavenly grace, that she may continue yours forever and daily increase in your spirit more and more until she comes to your eternal kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. By the Holy Spirit, we who believe and are baptized receive a ministry to witness to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, to love and serve those with whom we live and work. We are ambassadors for Christ, who reconciles and makes whole. We are salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. So we welcome you in Jesus Christ. Welcome, Linda. Amen. So we sing from the red book and we read from the blue one. So I want you to get the pew Bible that's in front of you, please. And in the second half, which is the New Testament, turn to page 94. And Mr. Jim Haggett is going to read from John chapter 13.
Our reading this morning is from John chapter 13, verses 1 through 15. This can be found in the New Testament portion of your pew Bible. Before we hear the word of the Lord, let us pray. creative and restorative God, open our minds that the mystery and joy of Easter might feel within reach. Open our hearts that we might believe that often seems unbelievable. And like Peter, in his hearing, may we move closer to you. Like St. Paul wrote in the Corinthian church, please wash us with your word today. God of the empty tomb, we are hungry for your good news. Speak to us with hope in our hearts. We listen and pray. Amen. Now, before the festival of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already decided that Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, would betray Jesus. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from supper, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, Lord, you are going to wash my feet? Jesus answered, you do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand. Peter said to him, you will never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash you, you have no share with me. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. Jesus said to him, one who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you, for he knew who was to betray him. And for this reason he said, not all of you are clean. After he had washed their feet, he put on his robe and had reclined again. He said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you. We have heard the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So we continue our series, Figuring Out Faith, in which we're taking phrases from the hymn, Come Thy Fount, and we're looking at them through the lens of Peter's life. Today it is Streams of Mercy, Never Ceasing. Lamentations, which is a book in the Hebrew Scriptures that was written by the prophet Jeremiah, captures the concept, well, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. Streams of mercy never ceasing. It's a beautiful phrase. Water is a powerful source. My dad once said to me, son, water always wins. He wasn't just talking about the water damage, the damage that water does to wood baseboards when a rambunctious 8-year-old isn't very careful with bath water. Water erodes concrete. It can smoothen jagged rocks. It reshapes the earth. As we just heard at the baptismal font, water also sustains and refreshes and cleanses, and water gives life. Similarly, God's mercy is a persistent force in our life that, thank God, can wear down our resistance to good things. That God's mercy comes to us and cleanses us. That God's mercy comes to us continually and over a lifetime can take away our jaggedness that we have and our resistance to God's way. So as we look at John 13, we're going to be talking about these streams of mercy. But first, let's get into our text. This is the last meal that Jesus will have with the disciples. They have entered the house, and there's no servant who is there to wash the dirt off of their feet. And Jesus looks around the room, and none of the 12 disciples are going to volunteer to do it. You know, they're probably like hands in pockets, sitting there. So, John, what you been up to today? You know, body language, all of that. Then the Lord of the universe leaves the room, gets a basin, fills it with water, gets a towel, and then he takes the feet of that tax collector, takes the feet of that rambunctious, rebellious zealot, and takes the feet of some of those fishermen into his own, and he washes it. And as Jesus is washing, Peter is watching, and he grows more and more uncomfortable. I'm Peter. I'm the rock. I'm the rock. Jesus called me the rock, and upon me he will build the church. But why do I feel this way right now? Jesus is washing their feet, and he's eventually going to get to me. Jesus said that he was the living water, and now he wants to drip water on me, but water will not touch me. I am the rock. You know, there's a reason why the game is called rock, paper, scissors. Because if it was rock, paper, scissors, water, you would always choose water, right? Water always wins. And you want to kind of like tell Peter, like, you better watch out, rock. Water always wins. Watch out. But why did Peter say what he said? Jesus, you will never wash my feet. In first century Judea, washing feet was a low status job that was reserved for servants. And Peter is uncomfortable that Jesus has upended the hierarchy. But Peter also realizes something very humbling. Jesus is doing for Peter what Peter was unwilling to do for other people. Why didn't I think of doing that? I've known these guys for 3 years. Jesus has always talked about serving other. As a matter of fact, that's all that Jesus has done as an example for 3 years. Why am I just now learning this lesson? So the guys walked into that room, and either they were oblivious to the necessity of service, or they refused to serve. And it wounds Peter's pride, and it causes self-doubt, and it humbles him. And pride and self-doubt are sides of the same coin. They're always related, because pride and self-doubt is actually how we deal with feeling vulnerable. When we feel vulnerable, we have a choice. When we feel vulnerable, we can get boisterous, like a puffer fish. You know, a puffer fish, like, gets all spiny, right? You've met some people who are puffer fish, right? You're like, what in the world? Like, if that person was an animal, puffer fish or porcupine, right? And they're just kind of like, we say, touchy, right? That person's touchy. They feel vulnerable. They feel like they always have to be on defensive. And it's because they feel at risk. So we can puff ourselves up. Isn't it interesting to say, like, in pride, you puff yourself up. On the other hand, we can do the opposite. We can make ourselves low and small. We can think low of ourselves. In some cases, we're uncomfortable with being seen because we think that if we're seen in that moment, that it means that being seen means that the other person is going to not love us. So we just make ourselves small because we feel vulnerable. And some people are uncomfortable with being seen. So they speak in exaggerated words about their unworthiness. And it can seem like humbleness, can it? Like, oh, that person's so humble. But it's actually how they're dealing with the uncomfortableness of how they feel about themselves. but it's actually a cover for how they're avoiding the truth. So pride and self-doubt, different sides of the same coin. And if you allow yourself to sit where Peter sits, and you say that there's 24 feet in that room, and how long it takes to clean feet, and then Jesus is like, oh, I got to go change this water. And then Jesus goes and gets clean water, and then comes back again. And then maybe he has to go get a new towel, and the dripping of the water. And you see he's eventually going to hold your feet in his hands. How comfortable would that make you feel about yourself, especially as you realize Jesus is doing for others, doing for me what I was unwilling to do for others. But did you notice in this passage that Jesus comes to Peter and the disciples and stoops low, not to condemn, but to care? Isn't that beautiful? There's no one like Jesus. There's no one like Jesus. Jesus cares. I mean, it's important to understand why Peter said the way that he says, and so that we can understand his words. But this passage is important because it teaches us who Jesus Christ is. So why could Jesus Christ do this? Did you know that Jesus Christ is not exempt from the same kind of issue in relationships that you and I are? Right, a couple of weeks ago in the forgiveness sermon, you know what we basically talked about? The relationships are dirty, right? They're not like clean and tidy, that it takes forgiveness, right? Jesus is not exempt from that. So how could Jesus go into that room and humble himself and serve other people? You know how he'd do this? Because Jesus is not prideful, and Jesus doesn't think of himself too lowly. Jesus thinks about himself appropriately. Jesus is not like King Nebuchadnezzar II in the book of Daniel. Remember the book of Daniel? You remember Daniel, the lion's den? You remember Meshach, Shadrach, Abednego? Do you remember them? They're thrown into the furnace, but they don't die. That Nebuchadnezzar said, is this not the great Babylon that I have built for the glory of my majesty? Jesus Christ did not say, I am the king of creation, and you guys are here to serve me. As a matter of fact, in a different passage, Jesus Christ said, I, the Son of Man, the Messiah, did not come to be served, but to serve. What? That's not what you would expect. But Jesus didn't think too lowly of himself either. He didn't say, well, since I'm here to serve, that must mean I'm lower than you. He's defying the hierarchy, but he's also saying this. Well, he's defying the hierarchy because in another place he says, the first will be last and the last will be first. So he is saying, I am the Son of Man and I am the Son of God. I am your leader, but I am here to serve with you. And the very first Christians, our siblings in the faith, thought this idea was so beautiful that they put it to poetry and they sang about it in the first century. And when it's translated into English, it reads like this. Don't look out just for yourself, but take an interest in others too, just like Jesus, who though he was God, did not think equality with God was something to cling to. Instead, he gave up divine privileges and took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above every name, that at his name every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory not of himself, not the glory to himself, but to the glory of God the Father. Everything that Jesus Christ did was not for his own glory, but it was to glorify God. Mm. Water wins. As Jesus is washing the disciples' feet, all of this is washing over Peter's heart. And he's contemplating what it means that Jesus Christ would have streams of mercy just flowing all over him. And so he says, Jesus, you're going to wash my feet? And Jesus is like, yeah, I just did the other 11 guys. What do you think I'm doing here? And then Peter says, you will never wash my feet. The emphasis is not on my. The emphasis is on never. It's like Peter saying, no, 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 no. No, 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 no. But, you know, you can't put that in a Bible text, right? Like, that doesn't sound very spiritual, does it? No, no, no. And Peter said, no, 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 no. And then Jesus says, well, Peter, if I don't wash your feet, you can't have a share of me, because this is just how the relationship works. Water's a part of it. It's going to get on you. And you may have picked up over the past several weeks with Peter, like there's an event or there's a teaching that happens, and he just has his reflex. And then Jesus will teach. And then he's like, yeah, you know, that's a good point. And then he changes. You know what the good thing about water is? It softens. That's a good thing about water, isn't it? Yeah. I love. Maybe somebody should do a study one day of when Peter changes his mind. That would be a good study. I love Peter because he's like, ready, shoot, aim. And then Jesus is like, no, 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 no. You got to aim like this. He's like, oh, okay. But he's willing for the streams of mercy to wash over him and to correct him. So Jesus says, water's part of the relationship. And Peter says, oh, then don't just wash my feet. Like, just wash over me. And then Jesus says, that's my Peter. There you are. There you are. And then he says basically this. Now, Peter, no, 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 no. Someone who's taken a bath and then takes a trip, they don't have to take a bath all over again. They just need to clean their feet. That's what I'm doing here. So I'm only going to wash your feet, meaning you're okay. I've already cleaned you. You're my follower. But I'm just cleaning your feet. Mm. And what's so beautiful is that when Jesus stoops down in front of Peter, it's to pick Peter up. And that's the beautiful thing about Christianity, isn't it? That are, when do you see Jesus, when someone recognizes that they misunderstand something in the Gospels, or that they have like really sinned, how many times do you see Jesus dogpile them? He's at Peter's feet, and Peter is brought low. He understands his misunderstanding, and then Jesus stoops down and picks him up. I love this. And then Peter's tone changes immediately. And you know why? I think that Jesus did that because he knows, as the text says, what's about to happen. Not long before this, Jesus has said to Peter, you are acting just like Satan. Get out of my way. So Peter needs to know once again, I've cleansed you. The streams of mercy have cleaned you. Just like the dirt on your feet, my grace and mercy have washed over you, and you're okay. And Peter is about to also experience the betrayal of Judas. And so he needs Peter to be the rock of the church. And then you may notice, and I'm going to say this in the most complicated way possible, Jesus, you may have noticed, changes the conversation a little bit from Peter's body to the body of the disciples, and Peter's feet to Judas. Did you see that? Let me see if I can round this up real quick. Peter, I have washed all of you, your body, but part of you, singular, is unclean, your feet. I have washed all of you, the disciples, yet one of you, plural, is unclean, and that's Judas. Does that make sense? But Judas doesn't just betray Jesus, he betrays his friends as well. And Peter's going to be beset by his own failures and the betrayal of his friends. And he needs to know that streams of mercy are going to help him in his heartache and his grief and the pain that he feels. And that is a message that Judas refuses to hear. And instead of being softened by water, Judas's cold heart freezes. And it busts him open. And it busts him open in a way that he despairs. And then he takes his own life. It's really sad because the streams of mercy were there for him just like it was for anyone else. As we come to the table in just a few moments, let's think about streams of mercy for us. The streams of mercy are so powerful, so good for us. You know, I'm realizing as I'm preaching this, streams of mercy would be such a good summertime sermon. It's really hard to think about refreshing streams right now, isn't it? But they are so good, and they kind of move. Think of it, in my mind, the streams of mercy also flow like the tide. When we're low, either through fear, failure, or just the facts of our bad actions, the gospel of Jesus Christ comes to us and says, you are a beloved child of God, and for you, Jesus Christ died, and for you, he prays. Like Lamentations says, the steadfast love of God never ceases. Never ceases. And one of the things that you can think about is this, that God cares for you in so many ways, even in ways that you would not care for other people. Have you ever been surprised by the care of God? He forgives you. He welcomes you. He cares for you. He prays for you, listens to you, and serves you. God's mercy never ceases. Jesus says, I've set an example for you. So the mercy that comes to you is to flow through you. And then when we are headstrong and prideful, it brings us back down and says, beloved child of God, you are created in the image of God, and you are also immortal, and all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and we all need a Savior who will wash us clean. We all need a Savior who will take the basin and the towel and the water and cleanse us. So you have been cleaned by that water, by that man who welcomes you all, each one of you, to the table. So as we come today, let's eat the bread at his table and let's drink from the streams of mercy once again.
Let us rise and sing hymn 207. Come to us, beloved stranger. be seated. Let us pray together to dedicate our gifts. Nothing is impossible or too wondrous for you, O God. So we pray that you would exceed our wildest imaginations as to how to use our tithes, offerings, and prayers to positively impact the beautiful people of our cities and towns. Amen. You may be seated.
All are invited to participate in communion. The bread that is provided is gluten-free. Beloved in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Supper which we are about to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, communion, and hope. We come in remembrance that our Lord Jesus Christ was sent to the Father into the world to assume our flesh and blood and to fulfill for us all obedience to divine law, even to the bitter and shameful death of the cross. By his death, resurrection, and ascension, he established a new and eternal covenant of grace and reconciliation that we might be accepted of God and never forsaken. We have come to have communion with this same Christ who has promised to be with us always, even to the end of the world. In the breaking of the bread, he makes himself known to us as the true heavenly bread that strengthens us to eternal life. In the cup of blessing, he comes to us as the vine in whom we must abide if we are to bear fruit. And we come in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are a pledge and foretaste of the feast of love, of which we shall all enjoy when his kingdom has fully come, when with unveiled face we shall behold him, made like unto him in his glory. Since by his death, resurrection, and ascension, Christ has obtained for us the life-giving Spirit who unites us all in one body, so are we to receive this supper in true love, mindful of the communion of saints. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. Join me in prayer, please. Holy and right it is, and our joyful duty, to give thanks to you at all times and in all places, O Lord our Creator, almighty and everlasting God. You created heaven with all its host and the earth with all its plenty. You have given us life and being and preserve us by your providence. But you have shown us the fullness of your love in sending into the world your Son, Jesus Christ, the eternal Word made flesh for us and for our salvation. For the precious gift of this mighty Savior who has reconciled us to you, we praise and bless you, O God. And so, with your whole church on earth and with all the company of heaven, we worship and adore your glorious name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. Thank you.
the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, and after having blessed it, he broke it and said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after the meal, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood given for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We are told by the Apostle Paul that as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And so with the worldwide church, we confess the mystery of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. You will first be served the bread will then return to the table, we will eat together, and then likewise with the cup. Let us commune with the Lord. Body of Christ, manna from heaven, let us eat. Blood of Christ, living water, let us drink. Please join me in prayer. We praise and thank you, O Lord, that you have fed us at your table. Grateful for your gifts and mindful of the communion of your saints, we offer to you our prayers for all people. God of compassion, we remember before you the poor and the afflicted, the sick and the dying, prisoners and all who are lonely, the victims of war, injustice, and inhumanity, and all others who suffer from whatever their sufferings may be called. O Lord of Providence, who holds the destiny of the nations in your hand, we pray for our country. Inspire the hearts and minds of our leaders that they, together with all our nation, may first seek your kingdom and righteousness so that order, liberty, and peace may dwell with your all people. O God, the Creator, we pray for all nations and people. Take away the mistrust and lack of understanding that divide your creatures. Increase in us the recognition that we are all your children. O Savior God, look upon your church and its struggle upon the earth. Have mercy on its weakness, bring to an end its unhappy divisions, scatter its fears. Look also upon the ministry of your church, increase its courage, strengthen its faith, and inspire its witness to all people, even to the ends of the earth. And author of grace and God of love, send your Holy Spirit's blessing to your children here present. Keep our hearts and thoughts in Jesus Christ, your only Son, our only Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. I'll ask you to stand as you're able, and let's sing from page 946. Thank you. We have a time of fellowship following this service through these doors, down the steps. Please stay as long as you're able to today. And friends, may the joy, peace, and love and fellowship of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit dwell with you this day, every day, forevermore. Go with God's blessing. Amen.